I know I often harp on the dangers of nuclear energy on this show. In fact, I've called it technological insanity. After all, with the risk of radioactive disaster and no legitimate long-term waste storage plan, what else can you call it? But what if there was a nuclear alternative that could safely and effectively generate clean energy? This nuclear option might exist with thorium, an element 3 to 4 times more abundant than uranium. So to explain everything in detail that is thorium and the possibilities of this potentially revolutionary technology, I was joined earlier by David Martin, chief executive at the Weinberg Foundation. I started it by asking him why thorium is a better alternative to uranium and plutonium.
For nuclear energy purposes, we really need to separate between thorium as a fuel, that's for the element, and thorium-fueled reactors. I think there's sometimes some confusion between the two. And both have advantages, and both have some technical challenges, and also perhaps some pitfalls as well. But I think in both cases, for both the thorium fuels and the thorium reactors, the advantages far outweigh the disadvantages. A thorium fuel would be one that would be a type of fuel that would go in a conventional reactor. So the current generation of reactors. So. A light water reactor, for instance, or a heavy water reactor, the kind of reactors that we've had for about the last 50 years, by and large, around the world. Now, thorium fuel in those types of reactors would it has a higher melting point, so you have higher safety margins. It has a whole bunch of physical characteristics that make it a little more stable than perhaps more stable, I should say, because the tests are still coming in. But it appears as though it will make it more stable, slightly more resilient, even when used in current reactors. And if it's used in current reactors, then you can mix it up with plutonium or other types of nuclear waste and use it as a way of getting rid of that waste. Now, the thorium-fueled reactors are the molten salt reactor, I think, is what most people think of as the thorium reactor. And the molten salt reactor is something that is, it's a step change, potentially, in how we produce nuclear energy, but perhaps even how we, a paradigm shift in how we produce all of our electricity at the moment.
I'm going to jump in here. Why is thorium currently dumped as waste instead of being used for energy purposes, and why wasn't thorium the primary element used when developing nuclear energy?
Well, it wasn't used to begin with primarily. I mean, there are two main reasons, right? The first reason is fundamentally the bomb. At the time that the nuclear industry, the nuclear energy industry was being developed, it was everybody you speak to will agree that the primary focus was on producing plutonium and fissile isotopes for nuclear bombs. This was the heyday of the Cold War, the 1950s, 1960s, 70s. And thorium doesn't produce any readily weaponizable waste. In fact, the wastes that come out of thorium are actually pretty difficult to handle, frankly, and would actually really inhibit somebody who wanted to build a bomb. The other side of it was, so there was the bomb, if thorium doesn't produce weaponizable material. And the second side of it was that thorium is fertile, so you have to have something to kickstart it, which is called a fissile driver. And at the time, in the 50s and 60s, there wasn't really much fissile material around. So they were really unable to consider starting up thorium reactors until the late 60s.
Talk about the 4-year thorium reactor test going on right now in Norway. What has been discovered so far, and how far do we still have to go until this is viable technology?
Those tests are specifically to develop a fuel that will be able to be mixed with plutonium, so it will be a good way of getting rid of the world's stockpile of plutonium. I think they will have a fuel on the market probably within about 5 years, certainly within the decade. In terms of the more radical reactors, the molten salt reactors, which are really the sort of almost the holy grail of nuclear energy, I think we're probably looking at a bit longer. If we were to have a big push, if we could go to the moon inside of 8 years, I think we could build a thorium molten salt reactor fairly quickly. But for a real, on the timescales and the budgets that we've got available at the moment, the resources and the budgets we've got at the moment, I think it's going to be a bit of a long haul, maybe 15 to 20 years. But what we really want to start to see, and what we are starting to see, are governments and energy corporations that are thinking outside of the box, and private inventors as well, really beginning to crack this problem. So I think if there was a major effort, an international push to develop these molten salt reactors, perhaps to combat climate change, then we could probably have something ready within 15 years.
David, you're talking about all these amazing capabilities that thorium has, almost zero waste, completely much more clean than the normal reactors that we're seeing now.
I'll just clarify quickly, thorium reactors of all types will still produce some waste. It's just that if you're talking about a molten salt reactor, the waste is far reduced, and it's a complicated question, but you know, they would produce less long-lived waste, let's put it that way.
Well, before you move on, can you break down the waste question really quickly? Because I think that people would appreciate, what do you mean by that?
Yeah, sure, okay. Okay, right, well, when one of the problems with the conventional reactors that we have at the moment, it's an issue, is that the solid fuel rods essentially, part of them becomes degraded over time. So you have to take the fuel out when you've only burned up about 3% of the fuel in the rod. That's one of the reasons that we have an issue with what's called high-level radioactive waste. Now, if you have a molten salt reactor, then because the fuel is liquid, you can just pass the fuel around the reactor continuously and burn up all of the what are called the actinides in the reactor, which means that the waste that comes out, you're not going to want to drink it, but the waste that comes out is far less long-lived, you know, would be safe within about 300 years. However, being nuclear physics, it's a little more complicated than that, in that for the 300 years, that some of that waste may be actually a little more intensely radioactive or harder to handle than even conventional waste. I just want to clarify something on this waste issue as well. Regarding conventional nuclear, the waste, I think there's a lot of misconceptions about the waste here. If your entire life were to be powered by nuclear energy, the current generation of nuclear energy, if your entire life were to be powered by it, it would produce the amount of high-level waste it would produce would fit inside a Coke can. People are often surprised to hear this. You know, we need to start thinking in terms of volumes of waste rather than tonnage of waste. Nuclear waste being very dense means that it's very heavy but doesn't take up very much space. So even with the current technology, it ain't that bad. We're talking about a Coke can for our entire lives, and that's for air travel,
you're saying that the current waste that we're seeing with the nuclear reactors on Earth today, the waste is not as bad as it's made out to be. Is that what you're saying?
I think obviously it needs to be stored securely. It needs to be handled well. It is handled well at the moment in general.
I mean, I do have to disagree with you, because I see day after day just stories of nuclear waste not being able to be stored properly. And it is really terrifying, I think, for people to understand how long lasting it is, if it is a small amount.
Yeah. A lot of the waste that we have at the moment can actually be reconverted into fuel. So it still contains a lot of energy. It's just that we need to develop the kinds of reactors, what are called fast spectrum reactors, that can actually, we have got reactors that are capable of using the waste we have as fuel and breaking it up. And making it less radioactive. Okay, so the UK, for instance, has a stockpile of plutonium at Sellafield that, in the right reactor, an advanced reactor, a fast reactor, could power the entire country for about 500 years. With nuclear waste, we do have lots of options. We could put them back in the right kinds of reactors and generate electricity from it.
After Fukushima, I think that many people, including me, are wary of pursuing any type of nuclear power or any type of nuclear energy. Why should people believe this is a smart and safe way to tackle our energy problems when we have more clean energy available, geothermal, solar, wind, wave, etc.?
I think we have to think about the scale of the problem that we face globally. For me, the reason I do the job that I do is because I'm an environmentalist. I always have been an environmentalist, and I'm worried about climate change. However, I want a bright future for, if I do one day have children, I'd like a bright future for my children and my children's children. Now, if we look at the global picture, it's clear that energy use is accelerating. Sadly, the carbon emissions, greenhouse gas emissions, are still accelerating. We have barely started to even slow the rate of increase there. So we've got a major problem. The IPCC said that we've only really got about 30 years to sort of pretty much decarbonize our entire economy. At the moment, there's only one way of doing that, and that's through primarily decarbonizing your energy use. And there's only one country on the planet, really, that's managed to decarbonize fully, and maintain a high level of living, high standard of living for its inhabitants, and that's France, which has 80% nuclear and some of the cleanest air in Europe. So I think we need to look globally here. You know, we've got a rising... I would like to see, you know, people around the planet be pulled out of poverty, and one of the best ways of doing that is through cheap energy. Now, all these coal plants and everything, they're all in the pipeline anyway. China's building thousands of coal plants, we know that. We need to find a replacement for those. They're not going to go back in the box, and renewables have a great role to play, as does energy efficiency. We need to use energy far more efficiently, but as does geothermal as well. But those technologies are just simply not enough.
David Martin, Chief Executive, Weinberg Foundation, really appreciate you coming on.